He's menacing. He's mad. He's the Doctor's most dangerous enemy. He's been 20 years in the time void. And now he's back. On set in Cardiff, the most evil being in the universe is getting ready to make an entrance.
I've never seen Davros's face on this.
Right.
I didn't want to show him too quickly. I didn't want to show Davros his features too, so you see him too early.
And action!
I warned you, Supreme One. Just as Dalek Khan foretold, the Children of Time are moving against us. But everything is falling into place.
It was quite hard to show you a little bit of time, because you've got the skirt, and you've got a gloved hand, and you've got some dials on the top, and then the rest of it's a leather jacket, and then the face.
Just move your hand through that speech, move your hand slowly across on the speech.
And your Dalek Khan is uneasy.
So you go with it, and it's that one.
Yeah. Action!
I could almost mistake that tone for one of victory. Beware your pride.
The Doctor cannot stop us.
And yet, Dalek Khan is uneasy.
Thank you!
And that was my huge responsibility to start with. And then from there onwards...
I'm just going to pull you back to your position.
To make sure that the prosthetics and the body and the figure looked authentic and terrific. It's just getting the right kind of shots to show him off.
Action!
Supreme One, the subway network, I would address it. Give me access.
Oh. We've lost him.
No. There's another signal coming through. There's someone else out there. Hello? Can you hear me?
Rose.
Your voice is different, and yet its arrogance is unchanged.
He's dead.
Welcome to my new empire, Doctor.
I can't.
But it's not Davros' first appearance in the studios. Complex creations need a trial run.
Wow, this is brilliant.
It looks wonderful.
Absolutely brilliant.
Chair looks so mean.
With most of the big designs of the monsters, we have what's called a show and tell. So a couple of days before the first day of filming, we'll get the actor in, we'll get the prosthetics on them if that's what they need, or the costume on them.
Oh, yeah,
we'll get them in the chair or the device or, you know, the whatever.
Can I have a lift?
And we'll just put the whole thing together and see how it works.
How malleable is all that? Isn't it?
It's very flexible.
It's absolutely brilliant.
Eyebrows going, everything.
Oh, look at that. That's extraordinary.
It went very well. Everyone seemed very happy. There was chills a little bit. I know myself and Phil Collins, who were kind of just stood there grinning ear to ear, really. It was just that lovely moment. We did it. We brought them back.
And here's brilliant. The Doctor.
It's cool.
How does it feel?
Fine, thanks.
Yeah?
Yeah, very comfortable.
Very comfortable. David and I spent the entire morning in a state of complete frenzy because we knew we were going to do the Davros show and tell that afternoon. We just kept laughing at each other and we were so excited.
One of my earliest memories of Doctor Who is Davros. It was 1975. So, I was a very small child, absolutely captivated by this extraordinary creature.
I mean, it's... is that... The wire, did the wires come out?
It doesn't disappoint when these things from your own sort of cultural memory is suddenly now part of the job you're doing for real. You never quite get over those slightly surreal moments, I don't think.
Davros may be the most dangerous enemy of all time, but the Doctor just can't do without him.
The Daleks are fantastic and iconic.
Humans will leave their homes!
But there is a slight problem with them. and that they're difficult to have long dialogue scenes with.
Daleks do not answer human questions.
You kind of need a character to be the voice of the Daleks who you can have a good old chin wag with.
Welcome to my new empire.
He's something of a way in, but he's also a great character. You know, this kind of Hitlerian megalomaniac.
The Daleks shall sweep away Gallifrey!
Dalek Series 1, Cybermen Series 2, Master Series 3, it had to be Davros, didn't it?
We shall become all
powerful! Yeah. Crush the lesser races, conquer their galaxy, unimaginable power, unlimited rice pudding!
He's probably the last one.
Yeah.
Left that we haven't exploited already.
I will teach you the folly of your words, Doctor!
And those decades of history and bloodshed and war, it's the ultimate to bring back.
I will destroy you and demonstrate the power of the Daleks!
Unpack the explosives!
Davros must die.
Hey, Stein! Kill him! I cannot die! My lure has worked!
Do you never do anything but kill?
You cannot kill me! I shall return!
I shall be waiting.
Do not do this, I beg of you!
Bye, Davros.
First Davros.
We will begin.
Is Michael Wisher. It's a wonderful performance.
You will tell me the reason for every Dalek defeat.
Who set the tone for everyone else to come. I think everyone else has been using his mannerisms.
With that knowledge, there will be no defeats.
And that cool, crisp Nazi fundamental intelligence.
You have the audacity to interrupt one of my experiments.
But he would have destroyed him.
Next up, an actor called David Goodison, who followed on as Davros, awaking from years of hibernation.
An eternity of waiting is over.
Still as mad and as evil as ever in a story called Destiny of the Daleks.
The resurrection has come.
Lastly, there was a man called Terry Molloy.
The Doctor and his TARDIS. Perfect!
Who brought all that intelligence to Davros as well. I think introduced one of my favourite things, which was the truly insane gurgling laugh.
Brilliant mind. Absolutely, phenomenally brilliant mind.
I will need a sample of the Mavillan virus.
And so wholly focused on solving a particular problem.
I will also need two Daleks for experimentation.
He'll follow that through, regardless of what the consequences are, and cannot see any lack of morality in doing that particular thing.
Welcome, Doctor. I have waited many years for this meeting.
I think you do give a level of respect to someone, even though he is an enormous force for evil.
I'm sorry to have detained you.
Is an intelligence, obviously, that is equal to the Doctor.
It was but a pleasure deferred. Now you are here. You will repay tenfold for the mental agony I suffered.
When it is head to head, and they know they're playing the chess game together, that's when it becomes fascinating. Peter's very good at that, and I really enjoy doing it.
You're like a deranged child, always talk of killing, revenge, and destruction.
It is the only path to ultimate power.
Now we have Julian Bleach in the part of Davros, who'd actually worked with us on an episode of Torchwood. He played the Ghost Maker in an episode called Out of the Rain.
What are you? There's not a breath in your poor, sad body. You're no use to me.
And funnily enough, though, it's like, yes, we cast him because he was so brilliant in that Torchwood, but Phil, our producer, had already spotted him.
I saw him in a show in the West End called Shockhead Peter. An amazing face, incredibly powerful, amazing eyes.
Behind these two doors stand such windows to that other world.
And when we were thinking about Davros, actually, he was the first person who sprang into my mind.
Weird. It was like it was just meant to be. All of us converged on Julian Bleach, who Andy Pryor, our casting director, also knew. And it's a gift, isn't it, when you see that performance.
It is only fitting that you should bear witness to the resurrection and the triumph of Davros, Lord and creator of the Dalek race.
And cut.
So he's back.
He's actually essentially still the same Davros.
I am Davros!
Anyhow, you bring back the Cybermen. They're from a parallel world, so we can do our own thing with them. When you bring back the Master, he is regenerated, and so every Master is as different as every Doctor is different. It's quite important to remember, I think, this is literally Davros.
A brilliant creation.
It's literally the same man. So I wasn't out to reinvent it in that sense.
Excellent.
And also, why reinvent one of the best villains ever? Well, I don't know what more you add to Davros. The one thing I did add was the body. We're not reinventing a classic, we're refurbishing a classic, I think, and reintroducing it to a brand new generation. It's like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
I always loved Davros when I was a kid, so to get my hands on him and get to do it, I've kept this one for myself. You know, the other guys in the workshop were kind of eyeballing the job, and it's like, no, this one's mine, I'm doing Davros. Julian had to come to visit us here. We put him in a chair, put a ball cap on him, and we had to take a mould of his head. And this is what I actually modelled the wax onto to create the look of Davros. Once that was modelled and approved, we then took moulds, and this is the front part of the mould. You can see Davros's face there. So inside there is a negative of Davros, and then this goes over the cast of Julian. And when it's filled up with silicon, you get something where on the outside it looks like Davros, but on the inside it's a perfect negative space of Julian's head. So it fits him absolutely perfectly. This is the eye itself, which will have a light inside it, and that will go in, and the eye will open and close. And that sits in the forehead part. The brief I got was to try and err more towards the original version of Davros, which was done in the 70s.
Now carry out my orders.
That was the kind of look that everyone felt was the best Davros.
Have you finished?
That would have been a very hard latex mask, which didn't move very much. So we're actually using silicon gel, which is, you can see, is a lot fleshier. In the series in the 80s, there's actually a scene, the last Davros episode, there's a scene where Davros has his hand blown off. So we've created this robotic-looking hand for Davros. Davros always had sort of slightly long fingernails and talon fingers, so we've got a bit of that kind of feel in the shape. But this is going to be all painted, some wires and things added to it to give it more dressing, some hard little panels. So that's just the basic structure on which we'll then dress up to make the finished hand.
So 5, 6, 3, 8, 9, 10. And action.
You were destroyed. In the very first year of the Time War, at the gates of Elysium.
I saw your command ship fly into the jaws of the Nightmare, child.
I tried to save you.
Julian can access a kind of brooding malevolence. Okay. He's a very sweet and lovely man, but he can take you to this rather dark, rather sinister, eerie place.
Imagine a single, simple Dalek succeeded where emperors and Time Lords have failed.
So when you put that in this grotesque latex mask, you've just got the perfect Doctor Who villain, I think.
Each one grown from a cell of my own body. New Daleks.
True Daleks. I have my children, Doctor. What do you have now?
Thank you very much indeed, long day. Well done, everyone.
It's very odd when there's somebody on set all day encased in one of these masks, and Julian would often sit quite quietly listening to any conversation that was going on, and then suddenly would just drop in some dry aside, which was particularly funny because it was coming from the most evil creature in the universe.
Bye!
The Daleks are part of Doctor Who, aren't they? I mean, without the Daleks, it's unlikely that Doctor Who would have survived as long as it did.
Now the Daleks are the masters of Earth.
Yeah, part of Doctor Who's DNA, and I think it's inevitable and right and proper that they should keep reoccurring.
Exterminate! Exterminate!
Returning Companions really pays off, especially with the Daleks, actually, because they've all encountered the Daleks, and so it has a great impact when they all hear those Dalek voices.
Put it through. Let's hear it.
Exterminate! 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 Exterminate!
There's no one running around going, what the hell is going on? Captain Jack was murdered by the Daleks. Martha thought they were all dead in 1930s.
What's that?
Sarah Jane, of course. Was there at the creation of the Daleks. So actually, you know, 30 years history start paying off here. And that's how big the Daleks are. That's how classic they are. That's what the legacy is. That's what their voice does to you.
Exterminate!
I'm 45 years old and my voice sends a chill down my spine, so I hope it's doing the same to the audience as it does to the companions.
I'm sorry, we're dead.
And so instead of being just a bunch of robots invading, it becomes really charged and personal. I think it's a very personal battle for everyone.
He was so young.
No matter that the stakes are very high and the Earth's at stake, it really strikes a chord in all those people.
They arrived in week five of Doctor Who back in the early 60s. And they've been part of it ever since.
Yes, I mean, I didn't really feel I was the two Doctors had worked against the Daleks, really.
You are the Doctor!
Yes.
You are the enemy of the Daleks!
Right. Exterminate the Doctor!
Exterminate the Doctor!
Until you have been chased down a corridor by three Daleks screaming at you, you have not nearly died.
The enemy of the Daleks must be destroyed!
There's something about the design that is timeless and brilliant.
There's something insidious about them, the way they move. They have no feet. They glide.
It's something about the fact that they are utterly non-humanoid.
The voice as well. The rasp.
I don't know why. I don't know why they work so well, but they just do, don't they? You just know when something works so well.
Honestly, you try and design something that is still being made and popular and used and powerful and successful 45 years later.
You are in our power!
They still work for a new generation. It's not just nostalgia. I know that because you see kids clutching their Dalek toys. There's something fundamentally brilliant about that design.
There is only one form of life that matters. Dalek life!
Something in 1963 coalesced and just focused and got it absolutely right from the word go. It's brilliant.
The real-life Davros, who conjured up the Daleks back in 1963, was BBC designer Raymond Cusick.
And you can see here how it kind of developed.
The Doctor Who team invited him to check out the modern version of his creation.
And some of these sketches, I think, were very much based on your original designs.
a request had come in that for Ray to come down, and I jumped at the chance. You know, I thought that, you know, that's fantastic.
Welcome to the TARDIS, Ray.
And he was a real gentleman, and it was a lovely day walking around, and I learned an awful lot about the Daleks and about how he approached things.
And this is our specialist store where we keep everything else, including the Daleks.
Oh, the Daleks.
The Daleks.
Yeah, yes.
I mean, the guy's a genius. He's absolutely superb, you know.
Ray, people say that you were inspired by a pepper pot.
Yeah, people do say I was inspired by a pepper pot, and I always think, well, if that all it takes to become a designer is it's a doddle. Yeah. But in actual fact, when I asked the special effects chap who was going to make them to lunch, I was trying to explain to him, you know, scribbling on the back of a napkin, and I picked up the pepper pot and moved it around the table. I said, it's going to move like that. No visible means, you know, no wheels or anything. That was it. And ever since then, people say I was inspired by a pepper pot. But it could have been the salt pot I picked up, I think.
Look at the original script. It's a very vague description. And he took that design and he took about 200 quid or whatever he had to make it with and produced something that's literally a piece of pop art, I think. It's like it's a truly enduring design classic.
There was a brief stage direction in the script which said that the creature didn't have any legs or arms and moved around on an invisible base. A bit puzzled by that. So I phoned up Terry Nation, the author, and asked him. And he said, there's a show currently in London, Russian Dancers. I said, I've seen it. He said, do you remember the peasant dance when the girls come on those long dresses and they seem to glide? I said, yes. Marvellous footwork. He said, that's how I think the Dalek should move. So I thought, well, it's got to be a human operator inside. So I drew a shape of a seat at the ergonomic height of 18 inches. Sketched a person on it and then drew the shape round that. That was how it really began, drawing a shape round someone sitting down. They had to be able to steer it, I thought. So initially I thought of a tricycle. As a cheap alternative, we came up with 3-inch diameter rubber tires with an open base so the operator could see the floor and operate it with his feet. And they got quite adept at it and they could flick these things around on the sixpence.
This way.
Very primitive inside, but they look great from the outside.
When they were taken down to the rehearsal room, I went down. I said to the director, "How's it going?" Well, he said, "Yeah, great." He said, "There's just one problem. I can't tell which of the Daleks is talking." So that's when I come up with the lights.
Our prisoners are showing preliminary stages of sickness already.
They're a work of genius. I think you really did something special there.
Okay, 1, 2, 3.
In a nearby rehearsal room, the modern Dalek operators are also reacquainting themselves with the Daleks.
What we're doing here today is we're doing a bit of troubleshooting. It's about 18 months, nearly 2 years, since we last did a Dalek episode. Isn't it? Is that right? Yeah, about 18 months.
I have been summoned!
So we're just making sure that everything works. We're all getting in, having a trundle around, making sure all the things fit and all the electrics work.
We need more bodies immediately!
Yes, Master.
It's all about the legs, really. If you've got long legs, you're in trouble. But, I mean, luckily it's all right. But, I mean, yeah, you've basically got this very simple seat, which is a bit padded at the bottom here. And it's trying not to bang your knees.
And, of course, your head is about here.
Yeah.
And then on top of it, you've got the neck ring. So you can only really see through about this section of the neck ring. And the rest is all blacked in.
Mm-hmm.
Daleks have no concept of worry.
We've got quite used to it anyway, though, haven't we, over the years? That visibility is always a bit restricted. You've usually only got one or two, and it's usually off to one side as well. You know, it's there in the Dalek, and the bit that you can see out of is sort of like that. So if you've got to look over there, that's fine. If you've got to look over there...
Come with me!
Just, you know, using the force, really. Just
and
guessing.
And, we're wearing these at the same time.
Oh, yes, you have to do that. Yeah.
And then there's smoke, and then there's... steam from the mini bar and the jacuzzi that you have in
yeah,
there.
Yeah, and the in-Dalek entertainment system, and you know, it's all in there. Yeah.
Now, join with me!
the hardest part is keeping out of the way of the mutant, isn't it, mutant?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, the mutant does, like, if you sit on him, you know, so you have to just sort of get in sideways. Yeah. Have him alongside, or have him on your lap, maybe.
I've got you under my skin.
No, not yet.
I have got you deep in the heart of me. You're so deep in my heart that you're really a part of me. And I've got you under my skin.
It really is the case that once we're inside and the lids have been put on and everything, people do kind of forget that we're in there because it looks like a Dalek and it's real and it moves and it twitches and we glide around. Again, it's a testament to what an amazing piece of design it is, that it comes to life and people think it's just a Dalek. It's not a bloke and some plywood and some fiberglass and some metal. It's a Dalek. Fantastic.
Hello, boys.
Hello.
Hello, Graham.
Hello.
Well, look, could you show me your twitching? Check us all out.
No, the foul one. Are you switched on?
I'm switched on, yes.
Can you move for us as well?
Yeah, sure. Do you want us to just...
Yeah. That's going to be good. Ooh. Once you know who they are, you remember their names, but once they start moving, I haven't a clue. Who's this? Who am I talking to?
Ready? 6-4-2, take 2, again, ready.
Action!
Dalek fleet in battle formation. All systems locked and primed. Crucible at 90% efficiency. The human harvest will commence.
My cut, just please.
Because I've got to under my skin. And I love you under my skin.
In the Doctor Who workshops, a very unusual Dalek is being brought up to date. He's Dalek Khan, back again and still hanging on in there after a history of bruising encounters with the Doctor.
Dalek Khan.
Dalek Khan was one of the only four Daleks to survive the Time War.
The last four Daleks in existence.
They unleashed the Genesis Arc and an army of new Daleks. When the Doctor opened a void, Khan and company escaped.
Emergency temporal shift!
They materialized in 1930s Manhattan.
Exterminate!
Where a showdown with a Doctor left only one.
Dalek Khan. Your entire species has been wiped out. Well, poor old Dalek Khan has obviously tried to save the Dalek race and to a great extent has managed it by travelling back into the Time War.
Emergency temporal shift!
Doctor! Which is clearly something you shouldn't do, and it has clearly taken its toll on old Dalek Khan, who's barely hanging together physically and emotionally.
So this is Dalek Khan. The skin being painted at the moment. This is all silicon, so it's all kind of very floppy and flesh-like. And this is from the mould of the version we created for the first series, you know, when you very first saw the Dalek mutant inside at the end of the Dalek episode. I've seen some illustrations and things like that people have been doing, and they always just put the eye in the middle, but actually, if you look very carefully, you can make out what used to be the whole face. You can see it's one large eye, and there's one kind of malformed eye here, and there's actually a mouth here.
Exterminate.
So we dusted off the moulds and we've cast out a new skin, and also we've got to rebuild all the animatronics, because in the first series, at the end of the series, we had the Emperor Dalek, and you saw the animatronic creature inside a water tank.
The refugees, the dispossessed, they all came to us.
And of course, once you dip a lot of metal in water, it tends to rust up a lot, so all the animatronics were destroyed shooting that episode in the first series. So yeah, it's a complete rebuild.
You cannot hurt me. I am immortal.
So Gustav's been working on all these tentacles. So these are all connected up to these great big servo motors. which will be hidden behind a lot of dressing, and the creature skin will go over and we'll operate joysticks, and as they do, the various tentacles will move.
Oh, creator of us all, the doctor is coming.
Yeah, me, John, puppeteering the Dalek Khan. On the main radio, we've got the tentacle movements, and on the separate one, we've got the eye blink. Okay. And then two squeeze bulbs, because there's a couple of bladders under the skin. So as he talks, on each line of dialogue, we make the face pulse. And it's just more movement. There's more tentacles moving. It's much smoother. So it's just a kind of evolution of the animatronics that's happened since the first series.
Rehearsing. And action.
Negative. No reports of Time Lord.
A big part of the Dalek is his voice, is the voice.
We are beyond the Doctor's reach.
The person who realises that really is Nick Briggs. He's a genius. He sits at the side of the set and delivers a completely chilling performance.
The Doctor cannot stop us.
Nick's involvement begins months before shooting, when the cast gathers for a first read-through of the script.
Nick comes to the read-through with his ring modulator.
Jacqueline.
Gary Milner.
Nick Briggs.
And he sets up a little speaker and he sits there and he patiently waits for the first Dalek line to come around, knowing that when it does and when he first booms across that read-through room, he's going to get a shiver of delight from everyone in the room.
I'm receiving a communication from the Earthbound ships that have a message for the human race.
Well, put it through, let's hear it.
Exterminate! Exterminate! Exterminate!
To suddenly hear it being created live, still gives me a frisson every time it happens.
Dalek fleet in battle formation. All systems locked at bright. Crucible at 90% efficiency. The human harvest will commence.
People never seem to tire of it. I know on the first one when I did it, you know, Christopher Eccleston, who'd never heard that before, he suddenly just stopped at his tracks and couldn't carry on and said, I wasn't expecting that. And likewise this time.
Commence the landings, bring the humans here, prepare the crucible.
I mean, it's lovely for an actor's ego. I got a huge round of applause on my first line, and then any little different nuance I did, that another round of applause.
Now the Daleks are the masters of Earth.
Shot of the Daleks on the floor, everywhere, all chanting.
Everyone together now.
It makes the job more interesting when there's a further development of the Daleks. So with the Dalek Supreme and Dalek Khan having gone completely bonkers this time, you know, there's a lot to think about and a lot to do, and that makes it... I mean, don't get me wrong, I love doing the whole exterminate and we obey and barking out commands. That has a fun aspect all of its own, especially since the Daleks are so cross all the time.
Supreme Dalek on the bridge!
But the Dalek Supreme... He is I think he's got a very high opinion of himself. So he has a kind of grand way of speaking, and he's kind of thinks he's the boss of everything.
Emergency! Locate the TARDIS! Find the Doctor!
And then further along that scale is Dalek Khan, who's been through the Time War and back and goodness knows where else. And he's sort of all in bits and sort of hanging there. And it's said in the script that he has this kind of strange musical quality to his voice.
I flew into the wild and fire.
Because his mind has just been blown by all this incredible experience he's been through. It's like all the neurons in his brain are firing in really weird directions. So he is all over the place.
He danced and died 1,000 times.
And he has this ridiculous giggle, and that was the thing that always got me into it. And Graham Harper, the director, kept saying, more giggling, I like the giggling, you know. So I said,
I'd love the giggling. Okay. That's going to be great. Yeah. Cut.
Very good. Thank you. Done that.
It's late at night on a street in South Wales, and there's an invasion in progress.
It's the first time ever in the new series that the Daleks have gone on location. So we've got rain, and we've got cold and weather, and it's brilliant. I love it.
It's quite difficult taking Daleks out of the studio because although they can fly and everything these days, they're not the most mobile props in the world. But no, it's great to see those kind of iconic science fiction motifs in an everyday urban setting. There's something very pleasing about that.
We're doing the scene where Rose and the Doctor are reunited after so many years, and just before they embrace, a Dalek comes out of the shadows and kills the Doctor.
Barnaby?
Yes.
On action, you're trundling from the back up to the front, turning and firing.
An exterminate.
Exterminate
then gun, yeah.
Well, you know, after whatever it is, 45 years, it feels good to be the Dalek who got him.
Action!
Sarah Jane said they were taking the people.
What for? Think, Donna, when you met Rose in that parallel world, what did she say?
Why don't you ask her yourself?
The Doctor sees Rose for the first time since Series 2. Oh, and they found each other. She's found him.
And, you know, you've sort of spent 12 weeks waiting for this moment. Because from that moment in Partners in Crime, when you see Rose appearing, also briefly, that tiny little glimpse.
This is the Doctor.
In episode 5. And then the other sort of slightly ghostly image in episode 10. And then the whole turn left episode.
Tiny.
Where Catherine meets this blonde girl.
Hello. Hi.
One has no idea who she is, no idea of the significance of who she is. Until the Doctor hears the words,
Bad Wolf.
You know, the whole thing's been building up to them meeting each other. You couldn't bring Rose back and deny her a meeting with the Doctor.
But before the Doctor can get to Rose, he's going to need a quad bike.
Do you know, I've never used quad bikes until I did Doctor Who.
490 take one, guide track, A camera mark.
Once you've got a quad bike, he can run as fast as he likes. He doesn't have to pull it, he doesn't have to pretend. He can really go for it.
Action!
So it does give you that energy and gives you fantastic performance.
You know, just in terms of acting a scene like that, if Rose is over there, and she's all you want in the universe, and you're desperate to get to her, you want to be able to run flat out, don't you?
B-camera!
Yeah, we've not even started yet. He knows that Rose mustn't come back, that it goes against all the laws of space and time. And yet, the chance to get to see her again is clearly something that he is very excited about and delighted by.
Finally, they get to this wrecked, deserted, nighttime, battered, Dalek-invaded street, civilization gone. The greatest distance, the greatest possible distance. There they are, her with a great big gun, him with the TARDIS, and they run towards each other like the biggest romance you've ever seen in your life.
You're lost, you can look, and you will find me. Time after time, if you fall, I will get you, I'll be waiting.
And as in all great love stories, he's cut down by a Dalek. I think that should happen in most films, really.
Exterminate!
Action! Gone with the Wind, Four Weddings and a Funeral, Notting Hill, they all should have had the hero cut down by a Dalek, and they would have been vastly improved for it.
Mercy. Yeah. Been busy, you know. Yeah. Don't die.
It's a moment of high emotion for all involved.
Don't die. Oh my God, don't die.
We can't have happy endings. Especially not when there's a cliffhanger to be worked up towards.
110 take 1A camera mark.
And action!
What do we do? There must be some medicine or something.
Rose is faced with the fact that she might be about to lose another doctor.
Just step back. Rose, do as I say and get back.
Just as she's managed to come goodness knows how many zillion light years to be reunited with him.
He's dying and you know what happens next.
What do you mean? She's very fond of this version of the Doctor. She hasn't seen him for a long time. She's completely in love with him and he's about to change form again. What do you mean, what happens next? She knows what it means, and it frightens her.
It's starting.
So yeah, the Doctor is mortally wounded and needs to regenerate, and there's not really any going back from that.
But you can't!
I'm sorry, it's too late. I'm regenerated.
So at the end of the episode, the Doctor is dying. It starts to glow, it starts to boil. It's changing into a new man. I've got no idea what happens next. And I'm going to be sitting down next week watching as rapt and as excited and as in the dark as everyone else. Honestly.
We're all about Glastonbury this weekend on BBC Three. It's like being there, but without having to be engulfed by 86 metric tons of mud. Tonight live is the performance people have been talking about. Jay-Z is at 10:30. And next, Elbow and Hot Chip featuring the day's highlights.